Hello and welcome to the Game Show Global Esports Cup Group Stage number 2. Right now we're in group number 1 of the European division of the tournament with 7 teams, and only 2 of them are going to move on. NIP, Stark, Monkey Freedom Fighters, Jalopy, Abraxas, and Team ATN are the ones that are going to be battling out for those 2 slots to move on to the next stage of competition in the Game Show Global Esports Cup. We're going to start things off with a pretty good series as both Stark and Monkey Freedom Fighters look to be contenders for those top 2 spots. We're going to have the Finland team Stark going up against Monkey Freedom Fighters, who looked like they might have disbanded, but after all, they are going to rejoin for this and a couple of other tournaments. And we'll have to see if they're going to be able to put up a good fight. Sing Sing's team, let's see what they're going to go for. Shadow Fiend Tusk will be the opener, and for the side of Stark, it'll be a Night Stalker for them. No big surprises in these first couple of picks. These teams might be slanted towards a more aggressive angle, but as a whole, yeah, nothing too much to write home about. These heroes offer a lot to the team, Shadow Fiend potentially with an early mech, but in general just with a lot of flash farming potential, a lot of early fighting potential. Land a couple of those raises and you're almost assuredly going to find yourself some kills, and if the Tusk gets his experience up and running, also absolutely terrifying. For Stark, their next pickup will be the Darkseer. Looks like a Darkseer Night Stalker dual lane, or at least at this point in the draft, that's what you'd expect. Those two can play off of each other nicely, although they are dual melee. They're fairly tanky, and a Surge Night Stalker with Ion Shell is absolutely terrifying. You don't want that thing running at you, especially during nighttime, like the 4-minute nighttime even. Maybe they'll be able to find some kills, but that second nighttime is really where Night Stalker can kick it into high gear. Especially when played as a support, you usually are going to delay your levels a little bit by the fact that you are going to be splitting XP. But just that aggressive potential will force supports to stick in lane to make sure that Monkey Freedom Fighter's safe lane, whatever that may be, isn't going to be absolutely run over. As Night Stalker and Darkseer can do just that to a lot of lanes that otherwise would look pretty solid. Ember Spirit will be the ban coming out from Stark, and Razor the ban from Monkey Freedom Fighters. Razor's been seeing a lot more play as of late as a carry that can contribute a lot early on, and after Tusk commits, getting out of the fight can prove to be difficult. Maybe they're able to get a long static link on him, then Stark will go ahead and ban out the Undying. Heroes that would make it difficult for either sides to go aggressive, and even the Ember Spirit to a lesser extent would do just that, although I'd see the Ember Spirit having quite a difficult time in lane, and the Night Stalker Silence is quite good against him, still holding high ground with the Ember indefinitely, and a great Ember player could completely, well, mess everything up. And Monkey Freedom Fighters are very adept with the hero. Winter Wyvern will be the ban coming out from Monkey Freedom Fighters, but still, we have a couple of very notable mentions left inside the pool. Windranger for the mid, maybe for Stark's side, and Dazzle as a support, which is now going to be picked up by Monkey Freedom Fighters. The Dazzle's a great hero in general. Allows you to play a little bit more aggressively, maybe dive a little bit harder, knowing you have that safety net of the Dazzle's Shallow Grave to fall back on. And Axe being such an infrequent pick, and now that Darkseer and Nightstark are on the pool, almost definitely not going to be picked up by Stark. That Shallow Grave is almost going to be guaranteed, unless you can get on top of that Dazzle and burst him down at the start of the fight. Nightstalker's okay, I suppose, at getting on top of him at nighttime. Maybe just throw the Silence his way, Void and Smackdown. With a little bit of help, you'll be able to bring him down before he's able to get off that Grave, or at the very least, force him to use that Grave suboptimally. But Stark now are going to pick themselves up a Juggernaut. This is a 3 melee lineup coming out from Stark so far, and that might be a little bit concerning for them, but I don't think it comes at the sacrifice of too much of their laning presence. In fact, their lanes are looking fairly solid. The Tusk I don't see being able to put that much pressure against the Juggernaut, and maybe Monkey Freedom Fighters will instead look for another carry, or another offlaner, excuse me, altogether, to make sure that this carry from Stark doesn't get out of control. A Juggernaut, if you give him early momentum, can completely run over the game. Flash farms very quickly if you go with that Mask of Madness build, takes down towers fairly reliably with the Healing Ward, and does a lot of damage with the Omni Slash, although in different circumstances. Unless we see a Battle Fury Jug, which very well might happen this game, combined with the combination with the Darkseer isn't as nearly as impressive as it could be, but if you have either the Cleave from a Magnus or the Cleave from Battle Fury Juggernaut, can do a lot in combination with that Vacuum Wall combo. Which is one of the selling points for going for Battle Fury Jug, although I think this game, it's going to be more likely that we just see the FaZe, Sanji, Yashka, Mask of Madness, maybe a Mantis style. Standard fare for the Jug. Should allow him to fight more than well enough. However, it is worth mentioning that Tusk's defensive snowballs can be very annoying for the Juggernaut, especially with that Omni Slash. Can be completely absorbed if Tusk's play is on point. Monkey Freedom Fighter is now going to pick up a Batrider as their offlaner. Tusk will be bumped into more of a support role this game, but still, Batrider is one of those offlanes that once he gets level 3 to 5 or so, and there's some stacks in the jungle, want to back off, farm those up, and that'll leave some space for the Tusk in lane, which will make up for some of the weaknesses of Tusk in the support role. But now Stark are going to pick up that Magnus. I already talked about Empower comboing up with the Omni Slash, but this is going to be a very terrifying teamfight combination from Stark. However, the Batrider and the Tusk are going to make this very hard to pull off, especially the defensive snowballs and the shallow graves. There's so many ways for Monkey Freedom Fighters to stop the combo from coming out from Stark. But if the Magnus play is on point, it's really hard to fight into that. And also, very important, it's very hard to push high ground into that. RP and the vacuum to get them in close quarters. Now, it looks like Stark are lacking one of their supports, and Monkey Freedom Fighters will ban this Disruptor, a good ban, as getting them in those small enclosed spaces would be very hard for Monkey Freedom Fighters to deal with. But now for Stark, I think picking up something maybe like a Lina could be really good as one of their supports. Would work fairly nicely in combination with the Vacuum Light Strike or the follow-up to Magnus's initiation in general, a fairly aggressive support hero that could combo up with the Night Stalker to get kills. Stark's lanes are going to be a bit awkward, and putting the Magnus against a Shadow Fiend doesn't come without risk. The Shadow Fiend's going to be able to get a lot of room unless they rotate very heavily, and they do need to make sure that they have a support that at the very least can set up for the Magnus to find a skewer angle onto him, or at the very least have enough damage to kill off the Shadow Fiend if any sort of disable does connect. So Monkey Freedom Fighters don't completely run away with this game, as they very well might. I'm a little bit afraid for Stark, although they have a lot of synergy inside their team. I'm not sure if they're going to be able to tap into it. I'm not sure if we can call this a draft win for Monkey Freedom Fighters yet, but it is looking like Stark have a couple of weaknesses that are fairly abusable. That said, if they do make it through the laning stage, at least on even footing, find a Blink Dagger up on this Magnus at a reasonable timing. I do like the pace that they're going to be able to play these mid-game teamfights, especially around that 12 to 16 minute mark or so. That should be the time that they get the Blink Dagger up for the Magnus, so that's also the time where Night Stalker is going to be at one of his soft peaks. The ban out coming out from Stark is going to be the Slaughter, as Monkey Freedom Fighters were lacking a safe lane farmer. Combined with the Shadow Fiend, that minus armor would have been fairly difficult for them to deal with. It's one of the great ways to deal with the Juggernaut is just mass physical damage with some sort of initiator to get on top of him, stopping him from using his kit. Juggernaut would have struggled against that Slaughter a lot, and Juggernaut is very crucial for Stark to be able to pull through these fights. One of the major ways that they scale in damage this game. Monkey Freedom Fighter's initiation is going to be very single target focused this time around. Batrider, Blink, Lasso, Tusk's whole kit is focused on finding those pickoffs, and then being able to transition into those pickoffs with a potential Shadow Fiend mechanism is how their team is going to somewhat function. They also have a little bit of sustain thrown in by the Dazzle, but the general picture for Monkey Freedom Fighters is that they're going to want to avoid these 5-on-5 engagements unless they know that one of the crucial spells, the RP, or the Juggernaut's Omni Slash, is on cooldown. Stark aren't going to be able to take the fight as they'd envisioned it. However, the Juggernaut's ability to scale this game, with the Empower in particular, is terrifying. Even if Juggernaut goes for a more stats-oriented build with the Sanji and Yasha, his cleave damage is going to be insane. But maybe it's not going to be as absurd as Sven's cleave damage, as Monkey Freedom Fighters picked that up as their safe lane farmer. It's so rare that we get to see a Sven picked up without the IO, but I quite like it this game. Stark are going to have to get fairly clumped up inside these fights. They have to get close to their targets in order to deal the damage. It offers another stun to throw into the chain for Monkey Freedom Fighters, which is not usually something you see from your safe lane farmers. And God Strength Sven can give Empower Juggernaut a run for his money when it comes to the amount of damage he's able to pump out. I like Monkey Freedom Fighters' lineup a lot, I'm not gonna lie. I think they have a lot of tools at their disposal to pull this one out to their victory, but now Stark gonna find a Vengeful Spirit. The amount of plus damage on this Jug is gonna be stupid now. With the Vengeance Sword on top of it, the minus armor from the Wave of Terror, rather, from the Vengeful Spirit combined with the Healing Ward of the Juggernaut will open up Roshan very quickly to Stark, and it's also a great place for them to fight. that ability for them to take down Roshan is going to be very useful for them as a team, and is going to throw a lot of focus around that Roshan pit. That said, Monkey Freedom Fighters, no slouches either, especially when it comes to them getting vision inside the pit. Dazzle Ultimate, Tusk Shards, Batrider with his Firefly, all are going to make it very difficult for Stark to feel comfortable going into the Rosh. They'll need to find a couple of pickoffs beforehand, which isn't necessarily going to be as easy for them unless they blow one of their big cooldowns. It's going to be close, but I think the Monkey Freedom Fighters draft is just a little bit better. Although, maybe I'm just underestimating the power of the Empowered Juggernaut, which could absolutely demolish this game. Wonder why it was so zoomed in there, but for now we're going to back up, introduce our teams. For the most part, Monkey Freedom Fighters are using their tag. Sing Sing going to be handling the safe lane farming Sven. Arise on the Shadow Fiend, TPing up towards top, it's going to be Demon on his Batrider. The Dazzle is going to be played by somebody that I couldn't verify his name. Feels like it's deep within me, we'll just call him Dazzle for today. And last but not least, it's going to be a Tusk via Yapzor. On the flip side of the coin, we're going to have Stark. This is going to be difficult as their names didn't actually change when they went into the game. Okay, Sia is going to be on the Vengeful Spirit. Valix, I believe, is going to be your Night Stalker. Boogie on the Juggernaut. Magnus is going to be handled. Oh dear. I remember Magnus. That is going to be Nemphy on the Magnus. And last but not least, the Darkseer, who is going to take a lot of damage here, will be played by Trixie, and he might just die here with a heal bomb on two heroes. Yapzor draws it with one more punch from the Tusk, getting caught out as he tries to go down for a deep ward unsuccessfully. So when you want to go for those wards, often you're going to have to do exactly what Batrider just did and TP up towards top, but unfortunately for the Bat, looks like he was completely dewarded. Double sentry is coming up from the Vengeful Spirit to make sure that they have their pulls available. This sentry doesn't block the camp, neither does this sentry. Both of these together spot out pretty much the entire camp spawn box, if not the entire camp spawn box. I don't think there's a spot that you can use, at least not a common spot that isn't taken out by those, and Batrider's ward was no exception. Vengeful Spirit also gets some lane vision for the Juggernaut, which will help tilt the scales back in Stark's favor in this lane, but then again, on the flip side of the coin, the Darkseer wasn't able to get his ward out either, so Dazzle can pull to his heart's content. Mid lane matchup is going to be Magnus versus Shadow Fiend. Arise with a little bit of a better block, but he did go raise level 1 to secure that kill. He'll ferry out the south, he needs to get level 2 before he can start pooling up the souls, but once the souls do start coming out for the Shadow Fiend, it's really hard for Magnus to contest him and farm. Sure, the Magnus isn't going to be shut down either, he's going to have those shockwaves to constantly spam out, but one thing that I might have liked to see the Magnus go for would be level 1 in power, just to out-CS the Shadow Fiend for the first wave or two. Not something we're going to see here. Magnus instead is going to prioritize getting his bottle at a better timing. I think that's mostly up to personal preference and probably a good choice coming out from Boogie. Dual lane versus dual lane, it's going to be across the map as Batrider Tusk will be making their way up towards this top lane. Yapzor as well as Demon against the Jug. It's going to be difficult for the Juggernaut to get a huge amount of momentum here, but his farm isn't going to be entirely shut down. Batrider shouldn't be able to kill off this Juggernaut, although the spam of Sticky Napalm is going to be annoying. It doesn't really bother Jug as much as other carries, since he has the spin to somewhat deal with that and get out to safety, and also has the Venge to offer a stun. However, their aggressive killing potential against a solo battle, though it could have worked out for them, is a lot less now that the Tusk is behind them with a defensive snowball, can delay a lot of that time of the Blade Fury, which really is crucial for them to be able to get kills. Down towards bottom, the Nightstalker Darkseer is going to be applying a good amount of pressure to this Fen of the enemy side, but similar to the Juggernaut, is going to be completely shut down, although Sing Sing is going to have a little bit more difficulty than his counterpart on the enemy side of the team. Trixie in particular, the spam of the Ion Shells for Sven is going to be a nuisance. It's one of the reasons why Sven starts with so much regen, Tango, Salve, and Mango to sustain himself in a very obnoxious lane. However, once he gets his Morbid Mask up and running, the Sven should be able to farm, and the ability for Monkey Freedom Fighters to take stacks is immense. All three of their core heroes, the Shadow Fiend, the Sven, and the Batrider, benefit heavily from having a stacked jungle, and we'll have to see what Stark are going to do in order to stop that. But already we're seeing a rise starting to pull ahead in this mid lane. 12-5 compared to the Magnus' 6-0. And I don't see it getting much better for the Magnus as this lane continues. Not to be unexpected, Shadowfiend is a naturally good matchup here, but up towards top, the spin damage onto Demon, the Batrider looks like he's gonna fall. And they'll be able to bring him down. Left alone, the Tusk is going to need to make this rotation mid work. He's going to spot out the Magnus, shows himself and two illusions. Magnus is still flirting with the idea of going for a Shockwave here. We'll secure him one of his CS, but needs to make sure that he stays back any further than this, and a snowball into double raises would probably be his death. Those raises do sting a lot, even though they're only level 2, it gets worse down the line, but once Arise has the 3 points up in raise, could very easily look to take out some stacks. And it looks like those stacks will be prepared by the illusions of Yapzor. If Tusk is able to pull this off, this is a double stack across the map. They're going to ping it out, and it looks like he might have missed one of them. Let's see if these little turkeys are going to get out of the camp fast enough. It looks like the answer is no. The box ends right about there. Maybe a little bit further towards the right, but you get the picture. The chickens were a little bit slow. If he left that stack to the Batrider and instead focuses on the right-hand stack, maybe that works out a little bit better for Yapzor. But still, they should be able to get one up for the bat, which will allow Demon some way to catch back up. Batrider is going to decide to TP up towards top, and although under normal circumstances this might feel a little bit awkward, the lane's pushing back into him, so he's going to try to steal a little bit of this experience. But with the side pull coming out from the Venge, might prove to be difficult. However, there is a stack inside this camp. When you go for the side pull, the timing works out very well to be able to stack that up, and now they need to steal these last hits away from the Batrider. And Juggernaut is going to be successful. Vengeful Spirit got one of them as well. So Batrider is going to get significantly less income than he otherwise would have by contesting that pull camp. And Stark will be happy that the Batrider pretty much just softened up those big creeps for him. But Batrider is also not heartbroken. He at least got two of those, I believe. Maybe only one. Now Tusk going to bump into both the Nightstalker as well as the Magnus. Over spotted out by that ward. If he tried anything fishy, probably would have gone down. And since the Dire team knows about this, Trixie should be fine. Darkseer has the availability of Surge, and locking down this Darkseer to get the kill is going to be difficult. Although they do have Stormhammer and they do have Snowball, it's not probably going to be enough. Iron Shell be dropped inside this camp will allow them to farm up this side at a good rate. However, it looks like they're going to contest this. Pinged out, Monkey Freedom Fighters want to put a stop to this. Ice Shards will be thrown. They wall up the Night Stalker. Inside those Ice Shards, turns for the Void onto Yapzor, but he's very isolated. Stormhammer, and the Night Stalker will go down. Heal Bomb from the Dazzle will kill him. And now the Snowball 4, they catch out Trixie. The Surge is running out of duration. They will have another Stormhammer in 3 seconds if he pops his Mango. I don't think Stick Charges would do it. He's going to pop that Mango. Stormhammer will fly. Trixie is going to another heal bomb, and Tusk secures it. 3-1 is the kill scores. Monkey Freedom Fighters get a couple inside their woods as Stark were just a little too overaggressive trying to take out the enemy's medium camp and deny that away from the Batrider in particular. Denying away that would have been really nice for them, but Demon looks like he's going to have a reasonably timed Blink Dagger, although not the fastest you're going to see on a Batrider. It's still quick enough for them to be able to contribute, and Arise is getting out of control in this mid lane. Looks like his bottle's being crowed back to him on the Courier. Has the Aquila done comparatively? CS is not even close. They're going to throw a Snowball towards the Magnus, but he went under tower. Now the Void is going to mean that Yapzor tanks a couple of shots with the Shockwave connecting. Yapzor will fall. One of the downsides of going for that play with the Snowball is you can't stop it after you start it. Now Arise is going to be dropped very low. Another Shockwave. Arise, however, with the Dazzle will survive. Nice rotation in from the Dazzle to make sure that this friendly Shadowfiend lives. Still, that kill or death on the Tusk was mostly unnecessary. If it was going maybe on the Nightstalker, could have worked out, I suppose, but Nightstalker was too far back anyway. Would have ended up in probably about the same place and probably the same circumstances, if not worse, because if the Magnus didn't have to use his skewer to get away from the Snowball, it could have skewered him deeper under tower. I think the end tally, you just don't go for that, but oh, up towards top, Magic Missile is there, Omni Slash on a Demon. Those were some damn lucky bounces coming out from the Jug, but sometimes you get all the bounces onto a Batrider next to a Creep Wave. It just happens for you. That's going to tie up our kill score 3-3. The Juggernaut is still doing very well for himself, even though the Shadowfiend on the enemy's side is also doing quite well. Across the map, this game looks pretty even. We're going to have to see where the first couple RPs end up. That's one of the big turning points that could come out here from your Magnus, from Nemphy. My goodness, it's so hard when they don't use the proper names, and I might be messing things up. Don't get me wrong, I'm completely fallible here. It would just be better if Dota showed their official names every time they went into a game. At least a lobby game. Inside their pubs, I can understand them not wanting to use them, but up towards top, a dive onto Demon, looking for the Firefly over the trees. Can he get out to safety? It looks like the answer is yes. They don't want to go for that dive anymore, fearing TP rotations. And in general, just not feeling they're fast enough to catch out the Bat. And I don't really blame them. The Bat Rider probably would have been just fine. He'll pull off the creep aggro and fly back behind his tier 1 tower to hopefully mop up a couple of those CS. Although he misses them, the Bat Rider's farm is not terrible by any means. Still, the stacks aren't really there inside the Radiant Woods. Monkey Freedom Fighters have been very occupied with trying to help out their bottom and mid lane, so they haven't really had the time to make massive stacks. And anything inside their woods might just be Shadow Fiends. Region of expertise. Rides will have his bottle treads flying out to him on the courier. He has another raise to throw out, although it doesn't look like he's going to use it for this camp. He still has more than enough sustain to keep him flash farming. That's just what Shadow Fiend wants to do. He's more than 1,000 gold ahead of his lane opponent, but it looks like Magnus is going to be rushing straight towards that Blink Dagger. This is going to make those first couple RPs much easier for him to use. Something that Stark should also look out for is whenever they get more points of instant power, though for now is only level 1 for the Magnus and probably will be level 1 for a little while as he'll put the next point to Skewer, I'd imagine. It depends on how much they want to prioritize this Juggernaut's farm, to be honest. But it's going to accelerate this Jug to a pretty astonishing rate. Even now, he's pretty much keeping up with the farming speed of the Shadow Fiend, which in and of itself is pretty impressive. But another interesting thing coming up from this Juggernaut is skill build, which is one that we haven't seen for a long time, and it's kind of nice to see it. It's so sad to watch Juggernauts go for stats over a spin. Such a great early game spell for getting kills, and the cooldown reduction, the mana cost decrease, in general, it works really nicely for Juggernaut when you put more points into it. So he's gonna have a much more balanced build. Although it does go for stats, it's instead going to be prioritized over his crit, which in lane can mess up your last hits a little bit, and I like the choice. It's going to tilt them a little bit more towards the aggressive side of things. If you get an RP with spin on top of a couple of heroes, the damage it puts out is pretty insane. Pretty insane indeed. Things will slow down a bit for Stark. The situation, the second nighttime that I was talking about where they really start getting aggressive, is not for another 3 minutes. But by that time, they will have the Blink Dagger for the Magnus, and maybe they didn't get to go for that aggressive move earlier than the first night time is. This Blink Dagger is so critical for their team. Shockwave will fly, however, he's gonna miss a couple of these CS. Doesn't really matter. His farming speed isn't going to be slowed down much. Constantly shoved under his tower, however, the Magnus is going to be a little bit on the back foot. But speaking of smoke plays, looks like they're gonna go for one on the Radiant side. No, just grouping up behind their Shadow Fiend. Now, it looked like they might have considered going for some sort of gank. The Tusk is maybe not strong enough, however. He's level 4, doesn't have that Walrus Punch yet, and this is the time where he'd like to be getting some experience in lane, but just can't quite do it because the Juggernaut's holding very good creep equilibrium. Also, another one of the benefits of not going for the points in crit, you don't accidentally push your lane or anything of the sort, and with side pulls constantly being run, top lane just isn't a great place for the Tusk to be, especially when his rotation towards top would have been spotted out by a deep Dire Observer Ward that was placed out, and there also was a Dire Observer Ward towards mid lane. None of the avenues towards the top are very open, and although we had a couple of early kills, mostly based off the Tusk and the Dazzle, things have really slowed down almost to a crawl, as both of these teams are taking to the farming game. And I really can't tell who that favors much. These teams do function in different fashions altogether. Stark more on the teamfight side, and Monkey Freedom Fighters on the more pick-off-oriented team. Although Stark, into the super late game, aren't going to be running with nearly as much physical damage from two cores, the Shadow Fiend and the Sven, on paper would be able to carry the Juggernaut, the Empower, as well as the big teamfight ultimate initiation power of Stark. Kind of makes it to where that scaling issue isn't really that much of an issue for Stark, and even their other heroes can get a little bit of right-clicking power from the Empower and from the Vengeance Aura. Still probably a slight favor towards Monkey Freedom Fighters, as this passive early game will allow their Sven and Shadow Fiend to flash farm it up. Sven, however, has gone for a little bit more of an aggressive build. Not that we're super surprised at that. Surge down towards bottom. A Smoke Magnus is going to make use of this, or going to look to make use of this first RP. Can they find the angle? It looks like Sing Sing might be caught out here. The Darkseer is going to walk around the corner. They catch eyes onto the Beaver Knight. The Tusk is behind him, however, so Yapzor should be able to bail him out, and it looks like Stark aren't going to be able to find this angle of initiation, even with the Blink Dagger on the Magnus. He just wasn't quite close enough for them to be able to find it. I like the rotation coming out from Stark when you get such a big power level increase. With a Blink Dagger on your Magnus, you want to look to push that advantage as quick as possible. But now the turnaround smoke from Monkey Freedom Fighters. They're going to look for this Magnus. Blink Lasso into the God Strength. Sven, they have more than enough chain lockdown. Storm Hammer's there. Can't get out of there at all. Even with the skewer, wouldn't have been able to get it off. The chain stun was very nice. And now Monkey Freedom Fighters are going to get an advantage with that kill, and also advantage when it comes to taking down this tower. Tier 1 is going to fall very fast in mid lane, whereas the push down towards bottom for Monkey Freedom Fighters is a little bit more slow and steady. Although it looks like they might be able to take it, that mid lane tower is very important for controlling Roshan, which is one of the objectives that Monkey Freedom Fighters really will be looking to stop Stark from taking, as they do have a very good Rosh lineup. Silence that Yapzor, however, under tower is going to get dope. Stormhammer will bail him out, connects onto two, a little bit of cleave, but not a lot. Now Sing Sing needs to be careful. The Magnus is going to TP into the tower. He's a little bit late to the party. Shadow Fiend's going to join it as well with the mechanism up and ready for the team. And this is a delicate situation towards either side. However, Stark are the ones with the vision advantage for now. Behind the tower, they might be able to find that jump. Let's see if they get that angle. They're going to surge up the Magnus. He's going to just clear up the creep wave. It looks like nothing's going to happen. Although that could have been a fight towards either side, it's so very dangerous for either of them to commit. And without the Magnus, it is very hard for Stark to make that call. And I think it is the right choice to play things a little bit more defensively for both sides. Monkey Freedom Fighters also didn't need to get caught out there. But maybe they're going to catch this Nightstalker Magnus. Nice ice shards, but a skewer over will save Magnus a little bit more time, and he's going to be able to get out to safety, and then Blink towards Ben, continue farming up. Although Blink Dagger on Magnus is a great item, don't get me wrong, you kind of need another item to be able to sustain your mana usage. He barely has enough to get off his full combo right about now after using a couple of shockwaves in lane. Maybe treads, maybe arcane boots, we'll have to see what Magnus is going to favor. Arcane boots into Shadowblade could be pretty good, or arcane's force also acceptable. The force staff in particular is going to be really nice for kiting out the snowball, kiting the Sven, and in general just kiting the Monkey Freedom Fighters team. That item is great for both sides, as they tend to have a little bit of difficulty getting on top of you. Unless, of course, Blink RP or Blink Flaming Lasso. Shadow Fiend has purchased up his first item in the mechanism. Looks like his next item is yet to be shown, but there's a fairly large ancient stack for the side of Monkey Freedom Fighters. This should be farmed by Sing Sing, but for now, they're going to go for another smoke play. I like the tempo that Monkey Freedom Fighters are trying to maintain, trying to get ganks as soon as they have this lasso up and ready every single time. They'll leave the Dazzle up towards top, maybe pretend that he's just here to soak experience. If they show the Dazzle, could be very easy bait. They're going to TP in the Sven of the lane, and there's the lasso broken, however, by the Vengeful Spirit Swap. Will give her life to save her carry. That's OKC, I believe, on the Vengeful Spirit, and will be able to bail out her buddy. Vengeful Spirit is such a great hero against Batrider, and a counter that we haven't seen very often because Bat and Venge are both not very popular right now. And Bat's heyday, Vengeful Spirit was so much more attractive for just that reason. Although you might be giving up your own life, being able to save your allies is such a crucial amount of utility for the team and makes Monkey Freedom Fighters initiation a lot less scary. However, their pushing power is still there with the Warcry, 2 points in it from Sing Sing, as well as the God Strength active. They're gonna wail away on this tower. They have the mechanism from the Shadow Fiend too, although it looks like he wants to use this mech to potentially look for a fight in mid lane. However, Stark are chasing forward for the Dazzle. They have superior vision right now as it is nighttime. Nightstalker are leading the charge. I believe he caught glimpses of the Dazzle walking up to the high ground. They spot him out, silenced up instantly. There's no real way out here. The Skewer's going to pull him right into the Juggernaut. They didn't even need it. Darkseer gets it with the Iron Shield that he'd placed on the mag. 5-4 is the kill score as Stark are going to strike back, and across the board, that's slightly advantageous for them, I want to say, since they do thwart the kill on Juggernaut. Even though the gold exchange might be close to even, at least they saved their junk. If that was a Juggernaut kill, things would be looking a lot worse for Stark. And in fact, they're going to pare down the Monkey Freedom Fighters' advantage that they got from flash farming their stacks so well. Don't do about 1,000 gold, and the experience advantage really isn't that much either. Both of these teams can fight, even with this minor advantage towards Monkey Freedom Fighters. And with the RP still up and running, I think Stark are actually the ones with the teamfight edge. They get the Blink RP, they catch out Yapzor as he walks around the corner, spotted by this ward on the high ground. Nice kill there coming out from Stark, and not something you get to see very often. That was a beautiful RP. I like that they're willing to use it for just the small pickup, since it has been sitting off of cooldown for quite some time. They're going to look to take out the stack. This is something that Monkey Freedom Fighters cannot afford to lose. Arise is there with an Invis Rune Requiem. He's going to drop that, looking for the lasso. They catch out the Jug, but a swap back, and And that initiation's completely moot. The Flame Break is going to split them up a little bit, but Monkey Freedom Fighters can't really chase for much more, although they do have a lot of damage on Arise, and he is fairly tanky. He's going to take a Magic Missile on the front lines. Omni Slash, and Arise will fall! Although the Death Raccoon is going to do quite a number to Ice Cube. Or the Juggernaut, rather. I can't remember without looking at the scoreboard who he actually is to see his portrait. They're going to be able to take out the rest of the stack. This is huge for Stark, as the counter initiation for the Vengeful Spirit has been on point. The last couple of blasters just can't do it. Even though Demon's finding good angles, Vengeful Spirit's just in a better spot. Props to OKC. That Ancient Stack dying is a huge turn of events for their side. Monkey Freedom Fighters, although they are able to get a little bit of farm on the Sven in the meantime, that farm in the Ancient should have been going towards Sing Sing. And compare his farm to the Juggernaut, it's leaps and bounds behind. Although they do have to deal with this farm Shadow Fiend. We saw in that last fight that he is still fairly manageable. He has what looks like Sanjin Yasha in the works. On top of that mechanism, but these items, although good, items on Shadow Fiend, are a lot more linear in their scaling, and don't give you as flashy an advantage as like a Blink Dagger on Magnus, even though that's pretty much all the mag has. It'll be working towards that four step that I was talking about earlier. Now, he's doing so much for the team, whereas the Shadow Fiend's mechanism hasn't really translated into that much tower-pushing power across the map, or hasn't translated into teamfight wins for Monkey Freedom Fighters. This game is still very close. 6-5 is our kill score. Both of these teams are bringing their A game. Nightstalker will be working towards his Aghanim Scepter next, and as far as other items are concerned, the Sanjin Yasha is done on the Juggernaut. I already kind of touched on it, how the Sanjin Yasha this game, although usually it's not a super powerful item, the extra agility that it gives, in particular when you have Empower and when you have Vengeance Aura, means this Juggernaut's going to be hitting so hard. If he goes for like a Scotty next, or just a straight up Butterfly, this Juggernaut's going to be dishing, even though he doesn't go for any traditional damage items. They're a little bit more mixed in their potential in other games. Empower plus Vengeance Aura means that he's almost going to be hitting with double damage inside every fight, as long as the Vengeful Spirit's able to stay alive. However, they're going to look for a jump on the Juggernaut. The Vengeful Spirit is a little far towards the right-hand side. Wouldn't be able to instantly break the lasso if they go now. However, the Batrider doesn't know where OKC is, so he can't really make that move. And now he knows that OKC is in position as they start wailing away on this Tier 1 tower. In the meantime, the Shadow Fiend was able to take out the Tier 1 top, and now they want to look for the fight. Sing Sing's going to throw the Stormhair. It does a lot of damage onto 2, but with the Mechanism pop from the Darkseer, it's not going to do enough, and now Yapzor is committed a little bit deep. Their heroes are too low, Stark are going to call the retreat, and the retreat will be successful. That is going to be a nice trade for Monkey Freedom Fighters. They hold their Tier 1 tower, and they take the Tier 1 tower up towards top lane. The last remaining T1 on the side of Stark Esports' side. Things are going to slow down. Now with the 4 staff on the Batrider, maybe he's able to find that initiation a little bit easier. With the 4 staff, getting a range for that swap is going to be very difficult, and OKC's positioning needs to be on point. One of the issues with this counter against the Batrider is the range on Nether swap is fairly limiting. With a Blink Force, you're able to get out of that range very fast. We'll have to see if OKC is prepared. If he had a mobility item or had level 11, things change a lot for the Vengeful Spirit, but this next initiation for the Batrider is very important. But then again, so is the Smoke Gank for the side of Stark Esports, but maybe it's not a gank after all. Maybe they're just going to rotate into Roshan Pit. They take it so quickly, and they're going to make exactly that move. They have the Empower on the Juggernaut. They have the Minus Armor from the Venge, and even with just the Jug here, he'd probably be able to take it, but he has more than enough backup to fight around the pit. The Magnus is not going to commit himself inside the Rosh Pit yet, although he will to make sure they're able to empower as many heroes as possible. Fighting in such close quarters against a Magnus is terrifying, and he's going to again skewer himself outside in order to make that Blink RP angle very easy. The high ground healing ward also very important for them being able to take this, and Radiant team, although it looks like they have a pretty good idea, it's being pinged out by the Tusk. It's too late, and they're going to be able to kill it off and get a secondary life for their Juggernaut. This will allow them to siege a lot more comfortably, and Stark is starting to pick up teamfight momentum. The Eye of Scotty, the next time for the Jug, he's picked up his ultimate orb, and also an orb of venom that he has sold. Maybe he decides to go for a Mantis style here, but I think that's just Juggernaut deciding that he only wants the ultimate orb after buying from Quickbuy. Tier 1 tower mid is going to fall. The last tier 1 for Monkey Freedom Fighters is also going to hit the deck, but this time around they don't have a Shadow Fiend in another lane going for that momentum. They're going to get a last initiation, force that back onto the Darkseid. They blow him up, but the Omni Slash onto Arise will be thrown. However, not doing nearly enough damage. The spin will be dropped, and Juggernaut is sitting with so much minus armor from the Weave, and he needs to think twice about initiating here. Stark had been repelled, mostly because of a really good initiation from the Batrider. They'll jump forward, trying to get this Aegis off of the Jug, but the damage from the Sven is not enough, and he is going to pull out. Not enough to follow up there, but also not enough to punish the jump in from Sing Sing. 6-6 is our kill score, and this is precious time wasted by the side of Monkey Freedom Fighters. That Aegis of the Immortal still in their pockets for a long time, 4 minutes, until that expires. The first minute of having this Aegis really hasn't done much of anything. And if Monkey Freedom Fighters are able to keep that up every time they go for the push, next time around they'll probably have their Lazza before they commit for a tier 2. They'll be able to hold without losing any substantial structural damage, which will be great for them. We really have to wait and see how impactful this Sven is going to be. He's gotten a lot of assists, and in general, Singh is playing well. But at the same time, he hasn't been able to really stick inside these fights comfortably, since he knows that there's so many ways that Sark have at kiting him, and so many ways that they have of killing him off, even through BKB, although that looks like it's going to be his next item, as it probably should be. A great item on Sven, and a very core one at that. He probably needs a little bit more before he's able to think about just cleaving through the entire enemy side. But then again, maybe he doesn't have to cleave through the entire enemy team. They just need Batrider to isolate somebody. Whenever the lassos have worked, whenever they're not going to be swapped out by the Venge, Monkey Freedom Fighters can take these fights. Pushing up towards the top, they are going to start applying a little bit of pressure, but their tier 2 bottom lane is already almost completely fallen. Stark pushed so very quickly with his empowered jug. He's hitting for more than 220 pop. This is without any damage items, and without even the Eye of Scotty finished, which he's going to have in give or take about 1,300 gold. Monkey Freedom Fighters were able to put a little bit of damage onto this tier 2 tower, but it is only that, just a little damage. About 400 and some odd. Monkey Freedom Fighters are not really interested in fighting into this Aegis of the Immortal and into the RP. I don't blame them. I think this is the right play. Especially since it is nighttime for a couple more seconds, and they also have a darkness available for this NS. Usually, you'll see the Night Stalker in an offlane or in an offlane duel lane where he's able to get a lot of momentum. This isn't that Night Stalker, so his Aghanim Scepter is going to be a lot later than otherwise would be, but it's such an important tool on any Night Stalkers. The ability to take out all of the enemy's map vision with a gem as well as with the Night Stalker flying vision at nighttime is ridiculous to play up against. Not to mention just darkness being something to add on to that issue of the reduced vision by taking out the wards. The reduced vision from darkness is so much scarier. Stun in mid, gonna throw it to the creep wave, pulls off the aggro and will also stun up the jug, but he's still sitting on that Aegis of the Immortal and will have that for still another minute and a half. The tier 2 tower in mid should also fall. Stark, although they're not going to push high ground with this Aegis, got two tier 2 towers for it. They're gonna be super happy with how this has worked out for them. Monkey Freedom Fighters are on the back foot, but Batrider is renowned as one of the best heroes at holding high ground, and for good reason too. I mean, Stark's high ground defense is not bad either. It's actually probably a little bit better than Monkey Freedom Fighters, but they're not in a situation where they have to tap into that. Vengeful Spirit at this point just doesn't have the item to allow her to get in range to swap the lasso. Maybe she even decides to go for a Blink Dagger to make sure that she's able to thwart that Batrider initiation most of the times that happens, or at the very least, respond quickly enough. Vengeful Spirit's going to be sacrificing herself a lot this game, but really, her only death has been the one where she saved the Juggernaut up towards top. OKC has been playing very well in this Vengeful Spirit, even though his KD is by no means flashy, 0-1 and 5. It's a lot better than it should have been. Monkey Freedom Fighters haven't been comfortable enough to find these jumps, but now they're going to smoke. This is the move that is going to potentially change the momentum of this game, as Stark's Aegis is going to be expiring very, very shortly, within the next 20 seconds or so. I don't think that they're going to have it inside this fight, as long as they don't focus the Juggernaut first, which Monkey Freedom Fighters should be aware of. The Scotty is finished on the Jug, however, even without the Aegis, it's very difficult to bring down. The smoke on the enemy side, rather an Invis Rune, is going to pop the smoke on the side of Monkey Freedom Fighters and will allow the Magnus to blink and skewer back inside his base. However, the smoke is not without its benefits. They're able to get a deep ward while they're out doing this. However, this ward is pinged out by the Tusk. It's pretty obvious that it was placed down, or at the very least something inside their woods is. We'll have to see how quickly Stark will be able to take that vision away, but for now, it's going to stand as a very good spot for Monkey Freedom Fighters. Maybe they've successfully juked out Stark into thinking that, hey, maybe they're not going to go for something so obvious. Maybe the ward's down here towards the south a little bit, or maybe a little bit further towards the left, and they won't even go for the obvious, but probably better spot. Juggernaut's Aegis has expired. He's going to buy a TP scroll to replace that slot, although it's a significant downgrade for him. This Juggernaut is operating at almost max capacity. The Vengeance Aura is 3 points up into it. The Empower should be maxed, I believe, for the Magnus. And is. Ice Cube is dishing. Right now, even with just the Empower, is hitting for 140 plus 119. Add an extra 36%, an extra 50 damage, give or take, once Vengeance Aura is maxed. And they're going to be making Ice Cube do so much. And with Cleave during his Omni Slash. Although, under normal circumstances, Omni Slash is in a great combination with the Vacuum back. Vacuum plus Empowered Juggernaut is stupidly good. Stupidly good when heroes are in such close quarters to each other. Now that Gem is up for the Vengeful Spirit, the Aghanim Scepter is going to be up for the Night Stalker, and the NS should be probably the one to carry this Gem. He is going to do just that. Maybe he buys a Quelling Blade in order to be able to bring down the wards by his Lonesome, but as long as he has the Vengeful Spirit close by, or maybe the Magnus, they'll be able to take them out. Pick up the High Ground, Skewer back down, or Force back down, no matter what it is, they'll be able to take out the control that Monkey Freedom Fighters have. And now that Darkness has popped, Monkey Freedom Fighters' vision is significantly hampered. Right now, this range creep is about as good as it's going to get for them. These towers hardly see in front of them, and with only one outer tier tower remaining, it's so very terrifying when you don't know where the enemy team is. The Gem's going to scout out their last remaining ward on the outside of the map, and Monkey Freedom Fighters are terrified, as they should be. They're going to be stuck inside their base. Their greatest ability to come back into this game is a good high ground defense, mostly off of the back of Demon on the Batrider. But this Vengeful Spirit counterpick really is working wonders for Stark and making it so very hard for them to take those fights. The two lassos that failed this game have slowed down Monkey Freedom Spider's initiation ability and momentum so very slow that now Stark are the ones commanding lead inside this game when it comes to their control on the map, although maybe not when it comes to metrics. One good fight, and Monkey Freedom Fighters will find themselves with a advantage in gold, and they already have a lead when it comes to experience. These engagements could in theory go either way, but it kind of feels like Stark's ability to make sure that the enemy doesn't have any map vision is going to be such a significant advantage when Batrider's looking for pickoffs. Although Bat, of course, has a great ability to go in for the Blink Lasso Force Staff initiation, he kind of needs to know where Vengeful Spirit is relative to the target he's going on before he makes that call and before he makes that jump. Roshan's going to respawn in 40 seconds. This next Roshan is the one that Stark will probably look to push high ground with. And if not high ground, at least remove the last remaining outer tier tower from the side of Monkey Freedom Fighters. Oh wait, never mind. That has since been taken out. Excuse me. A gem from the Radiant side, however, is going to serve to help Monkey Freedom Fighters get some semblance of map control back. As good as Flying Vision is during nighttime, and for the majority of this game, it is going to be nighttime since the NS is on Stark's side, of Firefly Batrider is also pretty darn good. If they can kill off Demon, or if they can kill off the Night Stalker, whoever gets the gem taken away from the enemy team will have supremacy when it comes to their map control, which is so very important. And Batrider's actually gonna go for an Axe next, I like it. After Blink Force and Gem, all of the items after that are luxury, and I think the extra stats for Batrider are gonna help him out quite a bit. And this game, more than most, Stark with so many melee heroes, have the chance to be caught up by that double lasso so much better, but a vacuum back, RP onto three! Can they get the Omni Slash? There it is, and it's going to be a pretty darn good one. 2 years going to be dropped low. Defensive Snowball not going to save Tusk's life. He's going to die to the Darkseer. Beaver Knight chasing forward. Sing Sing's BKB has worn off. He's going to look for the Stormhammer, but can't quite decide the target to go on to. And now he's silenced up. There is no target to go on towards now. They get the lasso. Swap back over the Batriders now. Going to be stuck on the way backside of this fight. Arise is isolated inside the trees. Will go down first, and the only survivor coming up from Monkey Freedom Fighters is Demon on the bat. He'll be able to get himself out to safety with the raw mobility of the hero. But a 4-for-1 exchange that vastly favors Stark, mostly because of that beautiful way it started out. Although it doesn't instantly kill the two targets that drop down, the defensive snowball is a good tool against that style of initiation with the Omni Slash. By the time the Tusk was able to use that, he was already so stupidly low that he died to any amount of damage. I think it was Iron Shell from the Darkseer, maybe it was, I don't know, just a karate chop or something. No matter what, the Tier 3 tower is now going to take some heavy damage. Even without the Aegis, Stark will feel comfortable enough going onto this high ground. The Citadel is a nuisance. Now they're going to get the Blink. Ooh, looking for some sort of initiation. Batrider didn't have a lasso, so that was just a Blink in to get the Firefly down onto the ground in order to clear out the creep wave a little bit more, or maybe just scare Stark, I guess. Stark, get the Tier 3 tower for free. Now back off into the Roche Pit. They're getting so much momentum going their way. Now a Shadowblade on this Magnus. The initiation supremacy is going to be theirs. This 1400 health range creep is going to be a nuisance. Juggernaut will smack that one down as they go into Roche. Monkey Freedom Fighters know this is happening. They have good heroes to catch Vision inside the pit, but can they get here fast enough? They're going to make a beeline towards it, Arise leading the charge from the south, Tusk leading the charge towards the north, and they're going to look to make a collapse inside this Roche pit. But by the time they get there, it's already down. The Juggernaut is going to be able to take an Aegis Immortal, and now taking this fight is going to be very hard. Sen's going to drop the War Cry, Arise is in the middle of him, Stormhammer onto the Jug, but with the RP afterwards, they just can't do enough. The Batwing is going to look for a lasso, won't be able to pull him up to the high ground. Sing Sing is trucking, but now the Omni Slash flies, and Sing Sing is going to fall. So is Yapzor very shortly. They just need one attack onto the Tusk. They will be able to find it. They bring down the Aegis, sure, but now Arise is isolated. Skewer is going to miss. Magic Missile, however, is not. They lose their Night Stalker. The gem, I'm not sure who claimed that. We'll take a look at that after this fight as they chase down Arise with that Shallow Grave delaying a little bit more time. The gem status towards either side, one on Demon, one on the Vengeful Spirit. Both teams still have one, but again, Stark take a big fight. The silver lining for Monkey Freedom Fighters is the fact that Roshan doesn't give them an Aegis to push high ground, but it gives them an opportunity that's even better, and that's the fact that Sen and Shadow Fiend have no buyback, and even when they come back up, the BKB will be less in duration. We've seen how much this Fen gets kited when he pops that magic immunity. Stark don't really care. The Juggernaut in particular is just not taking enough damage, and now Empowered Up is going to be swiping through this melee barracks. The Vengeful Spirit's a little too far away to give them Vengeance Orb, but right now that's not what Venge needs to be doing. She needs to make sure that the lasso initiation isn't a problem, and it won't be for another 5 seconds or so. But they'll be able to take the melee barracks again for no real cost of their own. The Aghanim Scepter is up on the Batrider, but it doesn't feel like that's going to mean very much of anything. I'm not exactly sure the interaction between Vengeful Spirit Swap and Batrider Aghanim's lasso. I'd assume if you lasso the swap the first lassoed target, it'll break the lasso to the Batrider from the second, but the second will still be lassoed to the first, and if you lasso the Batrider, maybe they're all broken. I'm not sure. We'll probably see that this game, as I think Stark will probably get too caught out inside that lasso, and I'm pretty sure the Vengeful Spirit will be able to swap him out, especially since she now has the gold for the Blink Dagger, which I can only imagine is the item that she's going for, since she hasn't bought the four staff components already, and she has that Blink. Perfect item choice for OKC. It's her goal inside these fights, just to save allies. 0-2-11, she's playing a very good support game, and across the board, Stark are executing at a very high level. At a very high level indeed. Monkey Freedom Fighters, their late game, as I kind of already mentioned earlier on inside this match, is comparable, but only if they get Sing Sing the appropriate items. Right now, compare his net worth to the Juggernaut, and it's a pretty sad sight indeed. The Sven only has Blink, Helm, BKB as his effective items. Although he's picked up parts towards the Assault Cuirass, those items inside his stash aren't doing anything for him. And the Juggernaut has himself Sanjin Yasha, Butterfly, Scotty. He's incredibly hard to bring down. Monkey King Bar, though, in theory, would be good on the Shadow Fiend and the Sven both, won't be coming out for a long time. And Monkey Freedom Fighters is going to start feeling a little bit anxious. They're going to look for initiation onto the Juggernaut. They get the Blink Lasso, but a Blink Swap, and Vengeful Spirit will be able to save her ally. Although at the cost of her own life, and the Omni Slash completely wasted because of the Tusk Snowball, this fight still could go either way. They'll get the backing back. The RP is there. Beaver Knight is stunned on the ground. Can the Juggernaut focus him down? The Sigil slowing down his attack speed? The answer is no. Stormhammer will connect. The Juggernaut has to be careful here. Bounced back by the Flame Break, but still an absolute menace. Surged up. Will be running towards the enemy's side, looking to jump in, and now is going to start jumping onto Arise. The damage isn't significant yet. Arise is going to be dropped low. They'll go for the Blink. Skewer catches out both Sing Sing as well as Arise, and with that Shallow Grave expiring, the Shadow Fiend will go down, but maybe not before he spells the killing blow on the Magnus Death Requiem. They can't quite chase him. GG is called, and I don't blame him. It really looked like that was their last chance for a good fight on their own terms, and they don't bring down a single hero except for the Venge. I stand corrected. They'll lose the Night Stalker, but the cost of Batrider's own life. Demon will find a pickup. But now, Stark, at the very least, have secured themselves 1 point. Monkey Freedom Fighters really need to make this one a tie, because how the group works, it's 7 teams, only 2 advance, getting the 2-0 victory to secure the 3 points inside this round robin is so very important for them, and we'll have to see if they're able to accomplish it. I think a lot of it comes down to the Vengeful Spirit's play. She was on point. Every time they tried to go for an initiation, there's a Vengeful Spirit there. Maybe it worked out once or twice, but the Batrider pick didn't work out for Monkey Freedom Fighters at all. Even though they were able to get the appropriate amounts of farm, it didn't translate because their initiations were always stopped. And the same can't be said for the Darkseer and Magnus. They found the jumps. And with that, we're going to be moving on to game two in approximately about 5 minutes. I've been Grandis V. If you like the casting you've heard today, you can follow me at Grandis V on Twitter, and I'll be sticking around on these game show channels for at least another 6 hours or so. Maybe even a bit longer, as we have the American group stage number one coming up over there with some very fun teams to watch. See you soon for more of the Game Show Global Esports Cup Group Stage Number 2 European Group 1.